Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Johann Sebastian Bach, The Learned Musician, by Christoph Wolff, narrated by John Pruden. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Johann Sebastian Bach into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code Bach, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. Preface to the updated edition. Quite a few books on Johann Sebastian Bach have appeared over the past several decades, and in particular on the occasion of the last Jubilee year, 2000. Virtually without exception, either they are devoted to describing the composer's life and works, or they clearly focus on some aspects of his music. In contrast, the present book was intended as a decidedly biographical presentation, even though the biography of a musician cannot avoid discussing musical aspects and mentioning actual works. Therefore, I had to include essential musical references, but the discussion of specifically musical facts is limited to what is most necessary, and a detailed explanation of the composer's development and musical language is consciously omitted. Instead, the intention was and remains to update the current state of knowledge, what we know about Bach's life and the more immediate context of his being and his workings, which has not been done since Philipp Spitta, that is, for well over 125 years. For this purpose, as many accessible source materials as possible were taken into account and evaluated, but discussing them all, with their often varied interpretations of events, had to be passed up. The bibliography of this book makes this aim clear, even though the preface to the first edition did not say so explicitly. I have been asked repeatedly why Albert Schweitzer's Bach book of 1908, by far the most widespread and influential work ever on the composer, is not cited in the bibliography. The answer is both simple and unapologetic, because in no way does it involve neglect. Schweitzer, as a declared Wagnerian, given the impermanence of his insights for understanding Bach's expressive musical language, in fact contributed weightily, and thereby essentially dislodged Spitta. However, that certainly does not apply to the area of biography. In that regard, he not only depended on Spitta, but also lagged behind him in many ways. On the whole, Spitta's biographical sketch gave authoritative direction for the 20th century within the framework of a wonderful presentation of Bach's life and work. This orientation also pertains especially to Spitta's emphatic avoidance regarding the human side of Bach, which is difficult to approach and so is usually neglected. Therefore, this book offers an attempt, not restricted in a small part, such as Chapter 11, to diminish slightly the prevailing abstract view of Bach. Only in writing this book, and even more pointedly in the aftermath, did it become clear to me how much the late 18th century tradition of understanding Bach as a musical cult figure goes back to the composer's apparent furtherance and propagation of his self-image. In the end, what we know today is that Bach was a highly self-conscious man, one who was seemingly not shy about styling himself as a kind of star in his surroundings and in the circle of his students. The question of how much the basis for the picture of musical genius, for the view of the unchanging uniqueness of his art, goes back to Bach himself, I have pursued elsewhere. Most of all, the retrospective portrayals in the obituary, which go back to Bach's own reports, offer discernible traces in this regard, as does Bach's establishment of his historical place in the framework of the family genealogy and the old Bach archive. It speaks to the vitality of a branch of research when, in the space of roughly a decade, new knowledge has been uncovered that proves relevant to the biographical representation. Considering the ongoing systematic research in Central German church, state, and communal archives that has been undertaken by the Leipzig Bach Archive since 2002, we may be sure that in the future, further pertinent materials will turn up that will require future updating. All new and genuine Bach documentary material collected through 2006-2007 has now been published as the Bach Archive in Volume 5 of the Bach Documenta series. Documente zu Leiben, Werk und Nachwirken Johann Sebastian Bach, 1685-1800. Editor Hans Joachim Schulze. Kassel, 2007. The publication of the present reprint of my book, in addition to allowing for the silent correction of misprints in the main text, provides the opportunity of making material corrections and adding supplementary information that seems to me especially relevant from a biographical perspective. The following paragraphs address this purpose by briefly summarizing the most important new knowledge that has been represented from 1999 through 2011. Supplied with pertinent bibliographic citations and, where necessary, by relating them to the biographical context. To avoid costly changes, these addenda and corrigenda have not been worked into the main text. Only the dates in the chronologies were amended and corrected, respectively. Author of the Newton-Bach Analogy, 1750. The author of the open letter of August 28, 1750, signed A., in which the names of Newton and Bach were first connected with each other, was until now thought to be Johann Friedrich Agricola. However, the text must be ascribed to Johann Adolf Scheibe, whose name was often concealed under the pseudonym Alfonso, and who, after the turmoil from his 1737 attack had died down, wrote only positively about Bach. Kai Kupp, Johann Adolf Scheibe, als Verfasserzweier anonymer Bach Documenta, B.J., 2003, pages 173 through 196. Musical Beginnings, Buxtehude, Boom, and Reinken. The most important new findings regarding Bach's youthful years result from the discovery in 2005 of Bach's earliest music manuscript. The so-called Weimar Tablature, a composite manuscript, contains, among other pieces, a copy of Dietrich Buxtehude's longest, technically most demanding, and compositionally most sophisticated organ chorale. The elaborate fantasy on Luther's hymn, Nun freut euch lieben Christen gemein, Books W.V. 214. The clean and error-free manuscript that originated in Ohrdruf before 1700 is notated in German tablature, and was written by the 13-to-14-year-old Johann Sebastian Bach, provides the first reliable evidence for the unusually high level of proficiency and technical competence of the young student. It also demonstrates his early acquaintance with Buxtehude's organ music while studying under the tutelage of his brother, Johann Christoph. A second manuscript contains the famous and similarly extensive chorale fantasy On Wasserfluss in Babylon by Johann Adam Reinken, now the earliest known source of this unusual composition. Bach's copy indicates at the end, A Domino Georg, Boome Descriptum Anno 1700 Lüneburgi, written out at the home of Herr Georg Boome in the year 1700 in Lüneburg, and proves that the contact with Boome goes back to the first year in Lüneburg, if not before, and that it was the Lüneburg organist Boome who apparently put Bach in contact with Hamburg Meister Reinken and his music. Moreover, the document clarifies Boom's important role as mentor and possibly also as facilitator of Bach's stipend as choral scholar at the St. Michael's School, and suggests that Lüneburg represented a decisive step in the career of the young musician. On Johann Adam Reinken. Newly discovered archival records regarding Reinken's year of birth prove that he was not 99 when he died in 1722. The ages that Johann Mattheson gives in 1739 rest apparently on conscious exaggeration. Reinken was born in Deventer, Holland, in 1643. Therefore, at the time of his meeting with the Latin school student Bach, he was not yet 60 years of age, some 6 years younger than Buxtehude, although from Bach's perspective he distinctly represented the older generation. At the Hamburg encounter in 1720, he was 77. Ulf Grappentein, Reinken Johann Adam, Grove Music Online. Also his Zwillingskompositionsregeln aus dem Nachlass Johann Adam Reinkens. Hamburger Jahrbuch für Musikwissenschaft 18, 2001, 71 through 110. On Johann Effler. C.P.E. Bach could not, in 1775, answer what took his father from Lüneburg to Weimar, so Forkel's question has remained unanswered since then. My suspicion that the Weimar court organist Johann Effler had a hand in Bach's appointment to the Weimar court during the first half of 1703 is now confirmed on the basis of a previously unknown document. Michael Maul of the Bach Archive Leipzig was able to identify a note of Effler's dated March 26, 1678 in the public record office at Weimar that describes Effler's duties as organist at the Dominican Church, Predigerkirche, in Erfurt as Johann Pachelbel's predecessor. The note also contains an express statement that, of the best musicians, Herr Bach was taken into their ranks, and that he handles the clavier whenever they make music. During the period 1667 through 82, Johann Christian Bach was director of the Erfurt Town Musicians, which also employed his two younger brothers, Johann Aegidius and Johann Nikolaus. Their first cousin, Johann Ambrosius Bach, played in the group too from 1667 to 1671 as a violinist. After that, Ambrosius Bach's continued connections with Erfurt, he also married an Erfurt woman, led in 1684, a year before the birth of his son, Johann Sebastian, to an offer to become director of the town music company, which he declined. The direct musical connections that have now been identified bestow a new importance on Effler's relationship with the Bach family. They make it plain that the young Sebastian, at the latest in 1702 on his return from Lüneburg to Thuringen, if not earlier, could find an influential patron in the Weimar court organist. Possibly Effler had already played a role as a go-between in Bach's application to Sangerhausen. The contacts were not broken off during Bach's time in Arnstadt and Mühlhausen, so that Effler, in 1708, in arranging for his own successor, recommended Bach to the Duke of Weimar. In 1704, Johann Effler worked alongside Johann Nikolaus Bach in assessing an organ of the Collegiate Church in Jena. Here he turned out to be an opponent of mean tone temperament who, together with the oldest son of Johann Christoph Bach in Eisenach, demanding an organ tuning that, in addition to the genus purum of the customary keys, would enable the harmonically strengthened genus mixtum, or genus diatonico chromatico enharmonicum. Apparently, a modern temperament was preferred in the Bach family circle. Michael Maul, Frühe Urteile über Johann Christoph und Johann Nikolaus Bach, BJ 2004, 157-68. About the cantata Nach der Herr verlanget mich, BWV 150. This early cantata has been variously considered of doubtful authenticity. Hans Joachim Schulze was able to demonstrate that the work originated as one commissioned by the Mühlhausen town councillor Konrad Mechbach, whose name occurs in the cantata text in the form of an acrostic. Hans Joachim Schulze, Rätselhafte Auftragswerke Johann Sebastian Bachs, Anmerkungen zu einigen Kantatentexten, BJ 2010, 69-93. About the repertoire and context of the early vocal works. On the basis of a recent discovery in London, the cantata fragment Meine Seele soll Gott loben, BWV 223, ascribed to Bach since Spida, can definitely be stricken from the Bach canon. Remnants of the old choir library of St. Blasius's Church in Mühlhausen, together with an old inventory, have been tracked down in the Staatsbibliothek in Berlin. The works of Praetorius, Demantius, Schütz, Hammerschmidt, the elder Alle, and Briegel contained there were available to Bach, even if we do not know whether or how he used them. Hans Joachim Marx, Finderglück, Eine neue Kantate von J.S. Bach, von G.F. Handel, Meine Seele soll Gott loben, BWV 223, Gutenberg Handel Beiträge 10, 2004, 179-204. Daniel R. Melamed, Die Alte Chorbibliothek der Kirche D.V. Blasi zu Mühlhausen, BJ 2002, 209-216. About the tuning of the organs in Arnstadt and Mühlhausen. Johann Friedrich Wender, the builder of Bach's organ in Arnstadt, was also responsible for the successful reconstruction in 1687 through 91 of the organ at St. Blasius's in Mühlhausen under Johann Georg Alle, Bach's predecessor there. who evidently used tempered tuning early on. In 1690, Alla wrote an ode to the advantages of well-tempered tuning developed by Andreas Werkmeister, which allowed for harmonic triads on all semitone steps of the scale. So from the summer of 1703 on, Bach continuously had at his disposal instruments that set practically no harmonic or key limitations, a fact that clearly accelerated his interest in experimenting with extreme chromatics. Marcus Ratti, Die Temperierung der Divi Blasi Orgel in Mühlhausen, BJ 2001, 163-172. On Maria Barbara Bach. The surviving documents relating to Bach's first wife can hardly be surpassed in their limitations, recording only her baptism, marriage, and death. Nevertheless, Michael Maul of the Bach Archive Leipzig found a further small reference to her in the 1708 pew registry of the court church in Weimar. Under women's pews, Frau Bachinhof Organistin is listed as having sat on the right side of the nave in row 8, seat 3, diagonally behind the wife of court Kapellmaster Johann Samuel Dresser. Lebenszeichen von Maria Barbara Bach, Bach Magazine 4, 2004, 31, illustrated. A newly discovered vocal work from the Weimar period. The original source, printed text with autograph manuscript score of a completely unknown vocal work, unexpectedly turned up at the Duchess Anna Amalia Library in Weimar. It concerns an aria for soprano, two violins, viola, and continuo composed by Bach on the occasion of the 52nd birthday of his employer, Duke Wilhelm Ernst of Saxe-Weimar, on October 20, 1713. Bach set to music a 12-stanza German poem by the theologian Johann Anton Milius, 1657-1724, on the Duke's motto, Omnia cum Deo et nihil sine eo, everything with God and nothing without him. The music is composed in the form of a strophic aria with ritornello, a genre popular in late 17th century Germany but not previously found among Bach's compositions. The work, written for a prominent occasion, confirms Bach's privileged position at the Weimar court even before his promotion from court organist to concertmaster in 1714. Michael Maul, Alles mit Gott und nix ohne ihn, Eine neue aufgefundene Aria von Johann Sebastian Bach, BJ 2005, 7-34. Edition within the series Facsimile Reihe Bachscher Werke und Schriftstücke, Neue Folge. Editor, Bach Archiv Leipzig, Kassel, 2005. The aria will be listed in the Schmieder catalog under BWV 1127. Weimar Instrumental Works. The early history of the Sonata for Organ, BWV 528, which goes back to a hypothetical trio sonata in G minor for oboe, viola da gamba, and continuo from around 1714, offers one of the few plausible traces of Bach's chamber music in Weimar. Peter Dirksen, Ein verschollenes Weimarer Kammermusikwerk Johann Sebastian Bachs, zur Vorgeschichte der Sonate e-moll für Orgel, BWV 528, BJ 2003, 7-36. On the examination of the organ in Gera. Newly discovered documents bring about substantial revisions to Bach's commissions as organ examiner in the Thuringian city of Gera. They pertain to three, not two, organs built by Johann Georg Finke. Moreover, Bach's visit to Gera, previously assigned to 1724, must now be moved to the period May 30th to June 6th, 1725. Bach was accompanied by two people, presumably Anna Magdalena Bach and the barely 15-year-old Wilhelm Friedemann. The trip was probably connected with a visiting performance at the Osterstein Palace, the residence of Heinrich XVIII, Count of Reuss. He traveled from Schleitz via Gera back to Kutten in August 1721, and on that occasion examined the organ at the palace church, as well as the progress made in building the organ in the Church of the Savior. He even saw to it that the large commission for the organ in the municipal church would also go to Finke. In 1725, Bach received a top honorarium of 30 Reichstalers for his certification of the two organs, in the municipal church and the Church of the Savior. On June 3, 1725, the first Sunday after Trinity, the large three-manual organ in the Municipal Church of St. John's in Gera was dedicated by Bach. Generous expenses for overnight lodgings and entertainment, including supplies of wine, brandy, coffee, tea, sugar, and tobacco, testify to his special VIP treatment. In Leipzig, Bach's new cantata cycle was supposed to begin on the first Sunday after Trinity in 1725, as it had the previous 2 years. Because of Bach's absence at the beginning of June, the irregular rhythm of the third cycle was already destined from the start. Its opening cantata, BWV 39, was composed in the following year and performed on June 23, 1726. Michael Maul, Johann Sebastian Bach's Besuche in der Residenzstadt Gera, BJ 2004, 101 through 120. For further updated details on Bach's organ examinations, see Christoph Wolff and Marcus Zeff, The Organs of J.S. Bach, a Handbook. Translator Lynn Edwards Butler, Urbana-Chicago and Springfield, 2012. On Augustin Reinhard Stricker. New research on Bach's Cöthen predecessor, Augustin Reinhard Stricker, provides important information about his lost German opera, Alexander und Roxana, magnificently produced on the occasion of the wedding of King Friedrich I and Sophia Louise of Mecklenburg-Grabau in December 1708, repeated in January 1709 at the Berlin court. Stricker, at the time chamber musician, tenor, and composer of the Prussian court Capella, sang the principal role of Neptune, god of the seas. Additionally, the cast of characters included dancers in the entree of the Amours and Plaisirs, the Prince of Cöthen the Elder, Leopold, the Prince of Cöthen the Younger, August Ludwig. Moreover, listed among the supernumeraries in Neptune's suite as well as in the ballet scenes is Margrave Christian Friedrich of Brandenburg, the king's brother and later dedicatee of Bach's Brandenburg Concertos. Bach's later employer, at the time 14 years of age and a pupil of the Berlin Ritterakademie, apparently received dance instruction along with his brother and participated actively in musical performances. His acquaintance with Stricker, who moved to Cöthen as Kapellmeister in the summer of 1714, goes back as far as the opera performances of 1708-09. Hans Joachim Schulze, von Weimar nach Cöthen, Risiken und Chancen eines Amtswechsels, Cöthener Bachhefte 11, 2003, 9-27. About Cöthen performances of cantatas BWV 21 and 199. Among the anonymous copyists of the original performance material of the cantata Ich hatte viel Bekümmernis, BWV 21, Johann Jeremias Goebel has now been identified. Goebel was cantor of the Reformed Calvinist Municipal School and therefore responsible for the music at the Reformed Cathedral Church, St. Jakob's Church, in Cöthen. This circumstance evinces for the first time that, on specific occasions, Bach also provided music for worship services in the main Reformed Church of the Principality, and not just in 1729 at the funeral of Prince Leopold. Conceivably, the occasion for the performance of BWV 21 was a Day of Repentance ceremony held in Cöthen every 5 years. One such service occurred during Bach's employment in Cöthen on May 1, 1721. The discovery of the autograph violin part for the soprano solo cantata Mein Herze schwimmt im Blut, BWV 199, rounds out our information about the Cöthen version of the work. We now know that it was performed around or after 1720 without oboe, with viola da gamba instead of solo viola, and in the key of D minor, at low pitch, about 392 Hz. Michael Maul and Peter Volney, Quellenkundliches zu Bach-Aufführungen in Cöthen, Ronenburg und Leipzig-Zwischen, 1720 und 1760, BJ 2003, 97-141. Tatjana Schabalina, Ein weiteres Autograph Johann Sebastian Bach in Russland, Neues zur Entstehungsgeschichte der verschiedenen Fassungen von BWV 199, BJ 2004, 11-40. On a guest performance in Serbst. A recent publication turned up the text to Bach's festive birthday music for Prince Johann August of Anhalt-Serbst on August 9, 1722, which reveals the outline of the lost secular cantata. Probably on the same day, the 10th Sunday after Trinity, a corresponding festive church cantata for the Count's birthday was performed, but no traces of it have survived. Commissions for works and performances were apparently connected with a provisional joint administration of the Kapellmeister's office, which Bach looked after from nearby Köthen before Johann Friedrich Fasch took over the position in September 1722. One member of the Zerbst court orchestra was Johann Kasper Wilke Jr., brother of Anna Magdalena Bach, who had already made frequent appearances as a singer even before her marriage to the Köthen Kapellmeister. Barbara Royal, O vernuchte Stunden, da mein Herzog funden seinen Lebenstag, ein unbekannter Textdruck zu einer Geburtstagkantate Johann Sebastian Bach für den Fürsten Johann August von Anhalt-Zerbst, B.J., 1999, 7 through 18. Hans Joachim Schulze, Johann Sebastian Bach und Zerbst, 1722. Randnotizen zu einer verlorenen Gastmusik, B.J., 2004, 209 through 214. On the 1720 trip to Hamburg. The archival documents that deal with appointing the organist at St. Jakobi Church yield details of the procedures and prove that Bach had already come to a decision after his concert at St. Catherine's and before the audition of the other candidates. But they also point out that the expectation of a financial payment from Bach was hardly decisive for his rejectionist attitude. Philipp Tanner, Bach's Bewerbung in Hamburg, Eine Frage des Geldes, Hamburger Jahrbuch für Musikwissenschaft, 18, 2001, 207 through 231. About Leipzig arrangements of Köthen Cantatas. Bach's official inauguration was originally planned for Pentecost 1723, but had to be postponed for 2 weeks for unknown reasons. Yet after signing his provisional contract on April 19th, Bach first prepared himself for the earlier inauguration and scheduled performances of the cantata Wer mich liebet, der wird mein Wort halten, BWV 59, for Whitsunday, as well as Erhutes Fleisch und Blut, BWV 173, and Erwünscht es Freudenlicht, BWV 184, for the second and third days of Pentecost, respectively. Given the time pressure, all were parodies of vocal works from the Köthen period. However, when the date of the inauguration was moved to the first Sunday after Trinity, Bach broke off working on BWV 59. It remains to be seen whether this cantata in its four-movement form was performed on Whitsunday, May 16, 1723, at the Old Service in St. Paul's, the University Church. In any case, Bach postponed the completion of the three Pentecostal cantatas to the following year when they were performed at the Leipzig main churches. During his first year in Leipzig, Bach made greater use than heretofore assumed of vocal works from the Köthen years in addition to cantatas from the Weimar period. We may note that the cantata BWV 75 for the first Sunday after Trinity, still composed on Köthen paper, the cantata BWV 69A for the 12th Sunday after Trinity, and the first town council election cantata, whose original scores contain several movements as fair copies, reveal themselves as parodies rather than new compositions. The following movements can be traced to Köthen models: arias number 3 and 5 from BWV 75, the opening chorus from BWV 69A with its typically Köthen duet formations, based on BWV Appendix 50 unknown, and the opening chorus and arias number 3, 5, and 7 from BWV 119. Detailed comparisons between the Leipzig arrangements and their Köthen models provide conclusive evidence that the Köthen court capella, presumably like its Berlin predecessor ensemble and following French tradition, performed at low pitch, Tiefkammerton, about 392 Hz. Andreas Gluckner, Vom Anhalt Köthenischer Kapellmeister zum Thomaskantor, Köthener Werke in Leipziger Überlieferung, Köthener Bachhefte 11, 2003, 78 through 96. About the participants in Leipzig church music. The normal choral complement called for by Bach in his Memorandum of 1730, 1 to 2 concertists and at least 2 repianists for each vocal part of his elite ensemble, which has been cast into doubt by Andrew Parrott and Joshua Rifkin, is confined by 2 historical choir rosters, One from 1729 names 12 singers in the primary choir that Bach conducted, and another from 1744-45 names 17 singers. Moreover, it has become evident that Bach's instrumentalists and singers were regularly supported by substitutes and assistants from the town musicians and by professional forces from the ranks of university students. This applies in particular to Bach's private pupils, as shown in the case of his future son-in-law, Johann Christoph Altnickel. He moved from being a paid choir singer at the Mary Magdalena Church in Breslau to Leipzig, where he attended the university and entered Bach's ensemble, taking along two fellow students. Andrew Parrott, The Essential Bach Choir, Woodbridge, Suffolk, 2000. The latest exchange in a protracted discussion regarding Bach's Leipzig performing forces consists of three articles in the journal Early Music, EM, Andreas Glockner, On the Performing Forces of Johann Sebastian Bach's Leipzig Church Music, EM 38, 2010, 215 through 222, Andrew Parrott, Bach's Chorus, The Leipzig Line, a response to Andreas Glockner, EM 38, 2010, 223 through 236, Andreas Glockner, The Repianists Must Also Be at Least Eight, namely two for each part, The Leipzig Line of 1730, Some Observations, EM 39, 2011, 575 through 586, Barbara Viermann, Altnickel Faber Fulda, Drei Breslauer Choralisten im Umfeld Johann Sebastian Bachs, BJ 2003, 259 through 266. New cantata textbooklets and confirmed performance dates. Only six original printed textbooklets of church cantatas were known until Tatiana Shabalina turned up several more such booklets in St. Petersburg, as well as an exemplar of the book with Picander's cantata cycle of 1728. Several booklets corroborate performing dates previously determined only on the basis of a philological analysis of the musical sources. 1. September 3rd to 29th, 1724, for BWV 33, 78, 99, 9, and 130. 2. August 27th, 1725, for BWV Appendix 4. 3. June 1st to 8th, 1727, for BWV 34, 173, 184, and 129. 4. Good Friday, April 24th, 1734, for the performance of G.H. Stölzel's Passion Oratorio, Ein Lämmlein geht und trägt die Schuld, at St. Thomas's, under Bach's direction. Tatiana Shabalina, Texte zur Musik in St. Petersburg. Neue Quellen zur Leipziger Musikgeschichte sowie zur Komposition und Aufführungstätigkeit Johann Sebastian Bachs, BJ 2008, 33-98, and Texte zur Musik in St. Petersburg, Weitere Funde, BJ 2009, 11-48, Lein zu dir, Herr Jesu Christ, BWV 33. Facsimile of the autograph score, Scheide Library, Princeton, the original performing parts, Bach Archiv Leipzig, and the original libretto of 1724. Russische Nationalbibliothek St. Petersburg. Commentary by Christoph Wolff and Peter Volny, Leipzig, 2010. Bach and Stölzel. In addition to the Stölzel Oratorio, Mark Roderick Pfau discovered a text booklet that documents performances of Stölzel's cantatas by Bach in the fall of 1735. And Andreas Glückner argued that an entire cantata cycle by Stölzel in Bach's possession was presented in Leipzig that year. Moreover, Peter Volny was able to demonstrate that the cantata movement Becken will ich seinen Namen, BWV 200, previously considered an autograph cantata fragment by Bach, in fact constitutes Bach's arrangement of the aria Dein Kreuz, o Bräutigam meiner Seelen, from Stölzel's Passion Oratorio, Ein Lämmlein geht und trägt die Schuld. Mark Roderick Pfau, Ein unbekanntes Leipziger Kantatentexttheft aus dem Jahr 1735, Neue zum Thema Bach und Stölzel, BJ 2008, 99-122. Andreas Glückner, Ein weiterer Kantatenjahrgang Gottfried Heinrich Stölzels in Bachs Aufführungsrepertoire, BJ 2009, 95-116. Peter Volny, Bekennen will ich seinen Namen, Authentizität, Bestimmung und Kontext der Aria BWV 200. Anmerkungen zu Johann Sebastian Bach's Rezeption von Werken Gottfried Heinrich Stölzels, BJ 2008, 123-158. On Picander's Cantata Cycle and Bach's Library, Latin Masses, French Keyboard, Music, and an Illustrated Bible. Peter Volney uncovered at an archive in Mügeln, Saxony, a CPE Bach composing score with a cantata from the Picander Cycle, apparently performed under his father's guidance before he left Leipzig in 1734, as well as a score of an anonymous Kyrie Gloria Mass in the hand of J.S. Bach. The previously unknown cantata Ich bin vergnug in meinem Stande by C.P.E. Bach suggests that his father's church music performances in Leipzig after 1730 occasionally included works by his students, and that he apparently assigned at least some cantata texts from the Picander cycle of 1728 to his students rather than composing the whole cycle himself. This may also include the fragment Ich bin ein Pilgrim auf der Welt, BWV, Appendix 190, perhaps another composition by C.P.E. Bach. The manuscript of the anonymous Mass in E minor, which lacks an inner folio containing the end of the Laudamus Te and the beginning of the Qui Tollis movements, can be dated to the late 1730s. The work, most likely of Italian origin, indicates that Bach's Leipzig repertoire of Latin church music was larger than previously known. Newly identified sources also increased the repertoire of French keyboard music in Bach's music library by including important works by François Couperin. Second Livre de Pieces de Clavecin, 1716-1717, and Jean-Philippe Rameau, Nouvelle Suite du Pieces de Clavecin, circa 1728. Moreover, the origin trio BWV 587 has been identified as derived from an early version of a sonata in Couperin's Les Nations, which Bach most likely acquired in Weimar via Johann Georg Pisendel. Bach's collection of Lutheran Bibles contained the famous Marion edition with some 200 engravings, Frankfurt Main, 1704, that turned up in private possession and is now on long-term loan at the Leipzig Bach Archive. It shows the composer's autograph initials and 1744 as the year of acquisition. Peter Volney, Zwei Bachfunde in Mügeln, C.P.E. Bach, Picander und die Leipziger Kirchenmusik in den 1730, B.J. 2010, 111-151. Zur Rezeption französischer Cembalo-Musik im Haus Bach in den 1730, Zwei neue aufgefundene Quellen. In Organo Plano, Festschrift für Jean-Claude Sender zum 65, Geburtstag, Editor L. Colorilla and A. Negito, Bern, 2007, pages 265-276. And Fundstücke zur Lebensgeschichte Johann Sebastian Bachs, 1744-1750, B.J., 2011, 35-50. Kirsten DeLong, Couperin, Pisendel, Bach. Überlegungen zur Deiterung des Trios, BWV 587, anhand eines Quellenfundes in der Sächsischen Landesbibliothek, Staats- und Universitätsbibliothek Dresden, BJ 2007, 197-204. On Bach's knowledge of music literature and teaching methods. Surprisingly copious evidence has been found relating to the central thesis of this book, as expressed in its subtitle, The Learned Musician. The evidence demonstrates the systematic breadth and historical depth of Bach's study of older music literature and theory, as well as his pragmatic start in using this knowledge for his teaching of composition. Already during his time in Weimar, Bach supplied himself with a volume of masses and mass movements by the old master of classic vocal polyphony, Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina. This manuscript collection, which has only recently been connected to Bach, served above all as primary study material. Nevertheless, at least two of its works were later performed in Leipzig. Besides the known performance materials dating from around 1740 for a Missa Sina Nomine, an unknown Bach performance part from the same time appeared containing the Missa Ecce Sacerdos Magnus, a Cantus Firmus Mass directly connected with the Symbolum Nicenum of the B minor Mass. an autographed manuscript in the field of theory that must be considered a unique document relating to Bach's teaching practice, dates from the early to mid-1740s. Its first part contains rules formulated by Bach for handling syncopations in double counterpoint. Its second part offers a collection of excerpts dealing with the teaching of counterpoint, fugue, and canon that Bach compiled from Latin treatises of Zarlino, Calvisius, and others, together with Latin explanations. What Bach missed in older counterpoint teachings were the voice-leading rules for a five-part setting, especially in the framework of a modern, harmonically richer language. His absolute command of the art of multi-voiced composition and his feel for pedagogically handy rules led him to construct a regula J.S. Bachii, which bears on the prohibition of doubling certain intervals in a five-voice setting, and which can be confirmed in a previously unknown manuscript by his pupil Johann Friedrich Agricola. The systematic way Bach approached different contrapuntal problems, even taking into consideration the old church modes, shows the musically challenging mind game dialogue of the late 1730s that he established with his eldest son, Wilhelm Friedemann. Also appearing among these important and extensive studies first discovered in 1999 is the oldest indication that Bach began work in the art of fugue before 1740. Bach's various contributions to thorough bass practice, contrapuntal studies, and theory are now collected in the NBA supplement, Kassel, 2011. Christoph Wolff and others, Zurück in Berlin, Das Notenarchiv der Singakademie, Bericht über eine erste Bestandsaufnahme, BJ, 2002, 165-180. Barbara Wiermann, Bach und Palestrina, Neue Quellen aus Johann Sebastian Bach Notenbibliothek, BJ, 2002, 9-28. Walter Verbeck, Bach und der Kontrapunkt, Neue Manuskript Funden, BJ, 2003, 67-96. Christoph Wolff, Johann Sebastian Bach's Regeln für den Fünfstimmigen Satz, BJ, 2004, 87-100. Peter Volney, Ein Quellenfund aus Kiew, Unbekannte Kontrapunktstudien von Johann Sebastian und Wilhelm Friedemann Bach, Bach in Leipzig, Bach und Leipzig, Konferenzbericht Leipzig 2000, edited U. Leisinger, LBB 5, 2002, 275-287. Chapter 9, Musician and Scholar. Bibliographic reference concerning content and context of Chapter 9. Musik, Kunst und Wissenschaft im Zeitalter, J.S. Bachs, edited U. Leisinger and C. Wolff, LBB 7, 2005. Includes contributions on the Latin School of Bach's time, Peter Lundgren, on the rector of the St. Thomas School, philologist Johann Matthias Gessner, Ulrich Schindler, on the electricity experiments conducted by Bach's colleague Johann Heinrich Winkler, Miles W. Jackson, on literary theory in Bach's time, Hans Joachim Kreutzer, on music theory and the art of the possible, Thomas Christensen, on the concept of nature, style, and art in 18th century aesthetics, Wilhelm Seidel, and on Bach's empiricism, Hans Joachim Schulze. Latin Ode, BWV, Appendix 20. Among the most puzzling lost works of Bach's are the Latin odes composed for a ceremony at the university in August 1723, during his first year in Leipzig. Therefore, a report about this ceremony written in Latin by an academic with an explicit appreciation of BWV Appendix 20 is all the more important. Bach is mentioned there as sumus artifex, and of the pieces, it is said that they fit the occasion so perfectly that everyone admired them. Ernst Koch, Johann Sebastian Bach's Musik als höchste Kunst, Ein unbekannter Brief aus Leipzig vom 9 August 1723, BJ 2004, 215-220. The New Bach Students. The identification by name of one of the most important Bach copyists, Anonymous 5, leads us on the trail of a Bach pupil unknown until now. Kaiser, born in 1705 in Köthen, became a pupil of Bach's in or before 1720 and continued his instruction in Leipzig, where he simultaneously studied law and apparently was among Bach's closest assistants, perhaps serving for a time as his personal secretary. Returning to Köthen, Kayser functioned as a court and government attorney, as well as a chamber musician and court organist, and presumably also as organist of St. Agnes' Lutheran Church in Köthen, to whose congregation he belonged, as did Bach and his family during his time there. As the possessor of important Bach resources and as teacher of Johann Christoph Ole, 1738-1789, and Friedrich Wilhelm Rust, 1730-1796, Kayser must be counted as the leading agent in the transmission of Bach's music in the Anhalt area. He died in 1758. The cantor and composer Johann Friedrich Schweinitz, 1708-1780, turns out to be another important Bach pupil. He later became music director at the University of Göttingen and in this capacity preceded Johann Nikolaus Forkel, Bach's first biographer. Andrew Talle, Nürnberg, Darmstadt, Köthen. Neuer Kenntnisse zur Bach-Überlieferung in der ersten Hälfte des 18. Jahrhunderts, BJ 2003, 143-172. Hans Joachim Schulze, Johann Friedrich Schweinitz, a disciple of the famous Herr Bach in Leipzig, about Bach, edited, Gregory B. Butler, George B. Stauffer, and Mary D. Greer, Chicago 2008, pages 81-88. Repertoire of the Collegium Musicum. Items from the repertoire of Bach's regular Collegium Musicum concerts include compositions in a variety of vocal and instrumental genres by J.B. Bach, F. Benda, C.P.E. Bach, J.D. Heineken, G.P. Telemann, J.G. Graun, N.A. Porpora, A. Scarlatti, and G.F. Handel, many of them previously not identified as such. George B. Stauffer, Music for Cavaliers et Damas, Bach and the Repertoire of His Collegium Musicum, about Bach, edited Butler and others, pages 135-156. Bach's Music Rental Operation. Newly found documents about mailing costs for sending music to Bach's second-generation pupil Johann Wilhelm Koch, cantor in Roneburg, Thuringia, in the years 1732-44, provide evidence, with indications like several cantatas sent back to Mr. Bach for the regular renting out of Bach's cantatas, among them exacting works such as Herrgott dich loben wir, BWV 16, Schwingt freudig auch empor, BWV 36, and In allen meinen Taten, BWV 97. Since we are not concerned here with just a single case, we can assume that St. Thomas's cantor Bach was in a way functioning as a country church music director, taking care, to a certain extent, of his wider surroundings. Therefore, he carried on his music business not only in Leipzig, but also in the entire region. He could hardly have limited his distribution to his own works because his challenging compositions prevented anything like the thoroughgoing distribution enjoyed a generation later by the motets and cantatas of Bach's pupil and cantor at the Holy Cross Church in Dresden, Gottfried August Homilius. Michael Maul and Peter Wolny, Quelkenliches zu Bau Aufführungen in Köthen, Runeburg und Leipzig Vision, 1720 und 1760, BJ 2003, 100-110 and 120-134. The Art of Fugue and B Minor Mass. The chapter-like systematic organization of the Art of Fugue is substantiated by Gregory Butler. Peter Wolny provides that Bach's second youngest son, Johann Christoph Friedrich, assisted his father in the late 1740s. He copied, for example, the Fantasia Chromatica with its authentic title and previously unknown source of BWV 903 was acquired in 2009 by the Leipzig Bach Archive, and that his hand shows up in additions and corrections of the autograph score of the B minor Mass, his father's last vocal work. Michael Maul considers the possibility that Bach prepared his Mass for a performance on St. Cecilia's Day at St. Stephen's Cathedral in Vienna on commission by Adam Count Questenberg. My own book on the Mass discusses the work in the context of an increased number of performances of Latin church music in Leipzig during the last two decades of Bach's life. Gregory G. Butler, Scribes, Engravers, and Notational Styles, The Final Disposition of Bach's Art of Fugue, about Bach, edited Butler and others, pages 111-123. Peter Wolny, Beobachtungen am Autograph der H. Moll Messe, BJ 2009, 131 to 152, and Fundstücke zur Lebensgeschichte Johann Sebastian Bachs 1744 to 1750, BJ 2011, 35 through 50. Michael Maul, Die große katholische Messe, Bach, Graf Questenberg und die musikalische Kongregation in Wien, BJ 2009, 153 through 176. Christoph Wolff, Johann Sebastian Bach, Messe in H-Moll, Kassel, 2009. On Bach's last months and final illness. The last known written musical entries by the composer occur, as Peter Volney has shown, in the original performing parts of C.P.E. Bach's Magnificat, WQ 215, which was presented in Leipzig on either February 2nd or March 25th, 1750. The nature of the entries indicates his participation in the careful preparation of the performance, whether or not it took place under his own direction. Archival documents uncovered by Andreas Gluckner attest that Bach, despite the two eye operations he underwent at the end of March and the beginning of April, apparently remained officially in charge of church performances until the middle of May 1750. His substitute, the prefect Johann Adam Frank, was appointed only from May 17th, Whit Sunday, and functioned in this capacity until Gottlob Harrer, Bach's successor, took over on St. Michael's Day, September 29, 1750. The record of Bach pathology offers no new information, but strengthens the suppositions that Bach's vision problems and a possible stroke suffered in 1749 were brought on by mellitic diabetes, and that the harmful medicaments and other things, quoted in the obituary, which cannot be further specified but were administered during his post-operative treatment, led to a fatal infection. Peter Volney, Fundstücke zur Lebensgeschichte Johann Sebastian Bachs 1744 to 1750, BJ 2011, 35 through 50. Andreas Gluckner, Johann Sebastian Bach und die Universität Leipzig, Neue Quellen, Thiel E., BJ 2009, 159 through 201. Bernhard Ludewig, Johann Sebastian Bach in Spiegel der Medizin, Grimma, 2000. Anna Magdalena Bach as widow. New documents verify that Bach's widow received, aside from the pension distributed by the town charity office, regular donations from the university and from various other sources. With this income, she had relatively good financial security until her death in January 1760. Her unmarried daughters, who had shared a dwelling with her beginning in February 1751, and also from 1759 with her daughter Elisabeth Altnickel, who in the meantime had been widowed, received modest contributions from, among others, the university, although not until after their mother's death. Mother and daughters probably sought to better their livelihoods through their own activities, such as sewing. In any case, Elisabeth Altnickel is specifically referred to in 1771 as seamstress. Maria Hübner, Zur finanziellen Situation der Witwe Anna Magdalena Bach und ihrer Tochter, BJ 2002, 245 to 255. Anna Magdalena Bach, Ein Leben in Dokumenten und Bildern, Editor M. Hübner, Leipzig, 2004. I am most grateful to my publisher for making this updated edition possible. October 2012, Christoph Wolff. Preface. Less than a decade ago, I began the preface to my Bach, Essays on His Life and Works, by stating that this volume may well be understood as a book about a book the author doesn't feel quite ready to write. As far as I am concerned, things have not really changed since then. Moreover, I believe that it would be unrealistic today for anyone to attempt a comprehensive book-length study of Johann Sebastian Bach's life and works in the tradition of Philip Spitta's two-volume Johann Sebastian Bach of 1873 through 1880, written astonishingly at a time when only a small number of biographical documents had been found and published, and the Bach-Gesellschaft's edition of the complete works was barely half-finished. Spitta's magisterial work has challenged all subsequent generations of music historians, not so much to rewrite a full account of Bach's life and works as to update and adjust the image of Bach in order to bring it in line, as objectively as possible and as subjectively as legitimate, with the current state of scholarship. It is the second that has prompted this biographical portrait, forged on the eve of the 250th anniversary of Bach's death. Today, we have easy access both to the collected documentary materials on Bach's life and to his complete musical works and their sources. But rather than facilitating the task of a life and works study, the availability of the Bach Documenta and the Neue Bach Ausgabe and the volume of materials they contain make it a much more challenging, if not impossible, scholarly enterprise. At the same time, we have become increasingly aware of sources and documents irretrievably lost, as well as materials yet to be found and examined. As for the latter, while I was putting the finishing touches on the manuscript for the New Bach Reader, a former student of mine came across two previously unknown and highly informative Bach letters. And as this book went to press, I had the good fortune of finding the long-lost music library of the Berlin Singakademie in Kiev, Ukraine, containing key musical materials of the Bach family, primarily older and younger family members and less significantly affecting Johann Sebastian, but this book has still benefited, if only minimally. Both of these discoveries clearly indicate that the search for sources so essential in Bach scholarship will remain very much a work in progress. So, unlike Spitta, I have accepted the more modest task of writing a biography, or more accurately, a biographical essay. As one may expect, the subject of a biographical study determines the nature and method of the exercise. Two points must be stressed in this connection. First, from all we know about Bach's life, it lacks exciting dimensions and does not lend itself to a narrative that focuses on and is woven around a chronological list of dates and events. Moreover, Bach's biography suffers from a serious lack of information on details, many of them crucial. Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach was clearly aware of this problem when he wrote to Jonathan Niklaus Forkel, his father's first biographer, in 1775. Since he never wrote down anything about his life, the gaps are unavoidable. Indeed, it would not be difficult to devote entire chapters to what is not known about Bach's life. Thus, conjectures and assumptions are unavoidable, and this book necessarily calls for numerous occurrences of probably, perhaps, maybe, and the like. Yet, as I try to demonstrate in this book, it is not impossible to reveal, even in the case of Bach, the essence of a life. Second, Bach's music, though no substitute for biographical information or its lack, is a much stronger and more important presence, at least for us today, than the composer's life story. While it would defeat the purpose of a musical biography if the music were marginalized, the focus must nevertheless be on musical issues of a more general nature and on music as part of the composer's intellectual profile. A discourse on Bach's development as a composer, integrated with a more detailed discussion of individual works, would be the subject of a separate study that I hope to undertake later in order to complement the present book. The subtitle of this biographical portrait was not freely invented. The attribute "learned" appears in the letter of dismissal written in April 1723 by Prince Leopold of Anhalt-Köthen, someone who definitely knew whom he was describing. More than a mere formula, the word provided this essay with a strong focus on the atmosphere of learning and the spirit of discovery that determined much of Bach's musical orientation and philosophy, distinguishes it so significantly from that of other major musicians, and helps reveal his aesthetic goals. But well beyond quoting and elaborating on Prince Leopold, this book is generally indebted to a close reading of the primary documents, which I had the privilege of reviewing in great detail in conjunction with the updated, enlarged, and revised edition of the Bach letters and documents, now collected in the New Bach Reader. My decision to quote historical documents whenever possible is based on my view that these sources bring freshness and immediacy into the discussion of history, and that even though they may speak for themselves, they benefit from being contextualized while offering instant correctives to erroneous interpretations. A careful reading of the available primary sources, both musical and non-musical, is largely responsible for the contours and contents of this study and for the interpretive aspects that cannot and should not be avoided. Thus, when I stress, for instance, the importance, extent, and early maturity of Bach's compositional output before 1705, the emphasis is based not only on the relevant source materials, but on my reading of them. The same is true of my conclusions about the course of Bach's life during the year 1702, his reasons for moving from Mühlhausen to Weimar, the chronological and conceptual connections between the title page of the Well-Tempered Clavier and his applications for the St. Thomas Cantorate and similar matters. Details of this kind, taken together, may add links and facets to a biographical narrative, which in the case of Bach resembles a highly fragmented mosaic. All the more important, then, is every attempt to walk the bridge between two poles, the down-to-earth backdrop of Bach's life and the intellectual framework of his artistry. In more than one way, this book owes its existence to a long-established and close friendship that has led to a number of collaborative projects. When Michael Oakes, former Richard F. French music librarian at Harvard, moved his scene of operation to New York, he thought of twisting my arm, but found much less resistance than any other publisher's emissary would have faced in persuading me to write a biographical portrait of Bach. What made the project work so smoothly from the very beginning was not only our familiarity with each other's work and work habits, but from my point of view, his remarkable understanding of the subject matter, his constructive criticism, and his considerate advice. An author cannot wish for a more competent and thoughtful editor, and I wish to thank him for seeing this project through from start to finish. With special thanks, I acknowledge the vigilant copy editing of Susan Gaustet at W.W. Norton. I also take this opportunity to express deep gratitude to my friends and colleagues Hans-Joachim Schulze, Ulrich Leisinger, and Peter Volny, all of the Bach Archive Leipzig, for reading the manuscript, discussing certain points, offering many a helpful hint, and identifying errors here and there. Ruth Libby has once again been an indispensable assistant, for which I am most grateful. John McMurrah of the Harvard Graduate School of Design kindly provided his expertise on artists' renditions of the historical choir and organ lofts at St. Thomas's of Leipzig. No one, however, has contributed to this book as much, both directly and indirectly, as my wife Barbara, with whom I have discussed, performed, studied, and listened to Bach's music for nearly 40 years. My indebtedness and gratitude indeed go back that far, lovingly and completely. Christoph Wolff. Prologue. Bach and the Notion of Musical Science. What Newton was as philosopher, Sebastian Bach was as musician. C. F. Daniel Schubert, 1784-1785. Some 2 months after his 52nd birthday, Johann Sebastian Bach opened a copy of a new fashionable and deliberately progressive music periodical and found himself the subject of a fierce attack. Mr. Blank, he read, is the most eminent of the music makers, musikanten, in blank. So began an unsigned, controversial piece of music journalism in the form of a letter published in 1737. Bach, like any informed reader of the time, could easily fill in the blanks, Bach and Leipzig, especially after reading what followed. And while the sentence hardly strikes us today as inflammatory, the article's author and editor of the periodical, a 29-year-old upstart named Johann Adolf Scheibe, knew that the terms eminent and music maker contradicted one another. Indeed, combining them so ambivalently was a deliberate effort at damning with faint praise. A little further into the fictitious letter, and in a similarly oblique, even ironically devout manner, Scheibe refers to this great man who would be the admiration of whole nations, but only if he had more amenity, if he did not take away the natural element in his pieces by giving them a turgid and confused style, and if he did not darken their beauty by an excess of art. Of the numerous critical points in this vitriolic yet ultimately inconsequential piece of early music criticism, what offended Bach most was being referred to as a musicant, a mere practitioner. But Bach also had his defenders. In an elaborate response published the following year, Johann Abraham Birnbaum, lecturer in rhetoric at Leipzig University, immediately took issue with the utterly inappropriate label musicant as applied to Bach, who was apparently enraged by Scheibe's assault. The man in question is the Royal Polish and Electoral Saxon court composer and Kapellmeister Mr. Johann Sebastian Bach in Leipzig. The honorable court composer is called the most eminent of the musikanten in Leipzig. This expression smacks too strongly of the mean and low, and does not fit the titles extraordinary artist, great man, the admiration of whole nations, which are applied to the honorable court composer in what follows. The term musikanten is generally used for those whose principal achievement is a form of mere musical practice. They are employed for the purpose of bringing pieces written by others into sound by means of musical instruments. As a matter of fact, not even all the men of this sort, but only the humblest and meanest of them, usually bear this name, so there is hardly any difference between musikanten and beer fiddlers. If one of those musical practitioners is an extraordinary artist on an instrument, he is called not a musikant, but a virtuoso. And least of all does this disdainful name apply to great composers and those who have to conduct choruses. Now, let the reasonable reader himself decide whether the praise that is due the honorable court composer can be fully expressed by calling him the most eminent of the musikanten. This is, in my opinion, the same as wishing to pay a special tribute to a thoroughly learned man by calling him the best member of the last class of schoolboys. The honorable court composer is a great composer, a master of music, a virtuoso on the organ and the clavier without an equal, but in no sense a musikant. The controversy caught the fancy of Johann Mattheson of Hamburg, the most productive and influential writer then on the German musical scene, who weighs in on the disputed terminology in a 1740 collection of musical biographies. He readily admits that the term musikant, so much contested and resisted by some people, is usually applied to singers and instrumentalists, but he attributes its low regard to arrogance, for some despise the beautiful name of cantor and organist, and some even don't want to be called Kapellmeister, but only chamber or court compositor. Mattheson was deliberately tweaking Bach, who had by then acquired all of these titles, perhaps to express his frustration over Bach's persistent refusal to submit any autobiographical material for his long-planned biographical anthology, though he had been requested to do so for more than 20 years. In fact, for private purposes, Bach had actually put down a bare outline of his professional career for a family genealogy he was compiling around 1735. Number 24, Johann Sebastian Bach, youngest son of Johann Ambrosius Bach, was born in Eisenach in the year 1685 on March 21st, became 1. Court musician in Weimar to Duke Johann Ernst, anno 1703, 2. Organist at the new church of Arnstadt, 1704, actually 1703, 3. Organist at the church of St. Blasius in Mühlhausen, anno 1707, 4. Chamber and court organist in Weimar, anno 1708, 5. Concertmaster as well at the same court, anno 1714, 6. Kapellmeister and director of the chamber music at the court of the Serene Prince of Anhalt-Köthen, anno 1717, 7. Was called hence anno 1723 to become music director and cantor at the St. Thomas School in Leipzig, where, in accordance with God's holy will, he still lives and at the same time holds the honorary position of Kapellmeister of Wiesenfels and Köthen. At no time had Bach shown any interest in writing a more elaborate autobiographical statement, and he hardly needed to remind himself that his life was not exactly filled with exciting events. For a chronology of Bach's life, see Appendix 1 in the bonus PDF. Still, his plan for a concise genealogy would have made him ponder what it meant to have been born in a tradition that claimed not only a past, but also, as he could see in his own children, a future. Love and aptitude for music, in the words of the obituary, The single dominating force in the life of several generations of Bachs had pointed the way for him as well, from his first modest job as court musician to positions ranging from organist to Kapellmeister and cantor. Curiously, Bach refrained from calling himself a composer while specifically applying the term to his uncles, but assumed, with good reason, that titles such as Kapellmeister and music director themselves implied a function of composer. Moreover, he knew that the most prestigious title, Electoral Saxon and Royal Polish Court Compositeur, was yet to come, though not for 3 long years after he had applied for it. That title, which would unambiguously refer to his compositional activities, was finally awarded by the Dresden court in 1736, just after he had finished compiling the genealogy. Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach later emended his father's entry accordingly. Birnbaum, in his published defense, replaces the image of Bach the music maker with that of Bach the virtuoso, and, by consistently referring to his subject as the honorable court composer, emphasizes the importance of Bach the composer. In amassing material for the genealogy, Bach gathered manuscript scores of works by those older family members who were composers because he realized that only their music, not their performing activities, would document and preserve the clan's musical legacy. The collection, known as the Old Bach Archive, would later be preserved by his son Carl Philipp Emanuel. In this way, he could confirm his admiration for his father's cousin Johann Christoph Bach, whom he regarded as a profound composer, and his father-in-law Johann Michael Bach, an able composer. He could perform their music and then reflect on his own contributions to musical composition, contributions of a nature, quality, and extent that were unprecedented in the family. Not coincidentally, Bach found himself at work in 1733 on a special project that would occupy him for some time to come. On July 27th of that year, he dedicated to the Electoral Court in Dresden the Missa in B minor, the Kyrie and Gloria of what would become the B minor Mass. To Your Royal Highness, I submit in deepest devotion the present small work of that science which I have attained in Musik. Stripping the phrase of the conventional formalities and courtly protocol, the statement reveals what this work was to represent, his achievements in the science of music. He was not a musikant, but someone who held the directorship of music in Leipzig's 2 principal churches. He considered himself a musical scholar producing works of musical science. Characterizing Bach's compositional art in any general way proves an elusive task. But a strikingly passionate attempt was made by his son Carl Philipp Emanuel and Bach's student Johann Friedrich Agricola in their obituary of the world-famous organist, Mr. Johann Sebastian Bach. If ever a composer showed polyphony in its greatest strength, it was certainly our late lamented Bach. If ever a musician employed the most hidden secrets of harmony with the most skilled artistry, it was certainly our Bach. No one ever showed so many ingenious and unusual ideas as he in elaborate pieces such as ordinarily seem dry exercises in craftsmanship. More often than not, superlatives such as these provoke skepticism, but this statement, though penned under the immediate burden of loss and the pressure of time, presents a remarkably apt summation of Bach's most important musical accomplishments. It emphasizes that his music truly demonstrates the power of polyphony, an intrinsic harmonic structure, and an imaginative and original approach in the design of complex works. No specific compositions are mentioned, such particulars being deemed unnecessary by the obituary authors. And indeed, any of the works, whether the B minor Mass or the St. Matthew Passion, the well-tempered clavier or the Orgel Buchlein, the Brandenburg Concertos or the Sonatas and Partitas for accompanied violin, corroborate and deepen the judgment rendered. In the closing section of the obituary, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach and Agricola enumerate further talents of Bach's. His ability to recognize without an instant's hesitation the intricate developmental potential of a musical subject, his inclination toward a serious style without rejecting the comic, his facility for reading large scores, his fine musical ear, and his skill in conducting. the confident declaration that Bach was the greatest organist and clavier player that we have ever had is followed by observations regarding his art of improvisation and his use of strange, new, expressive, and beautiful ideas, his most perfect accuracy in performance, his invention of a new fingering system, his intimate knowledge of organ construction, his facility in tuning the harpsichord, and the fact that he knew of no tonalities that, because of impure intonation, one must avoid. A noteworthy comment in those days when few keyboard performers dared to wander beyond keys with three sharps or flats. The obituary also associates Bach's music with polyphony in its greatest strength, with employing the most hidden secrets of harmony with the most skilled artistry, and with ingenious and unusual ideas pervading elaborate pieces. This extremely flattering language must be understood against the background of criticism to which Bach was subjected, most directly in Scheibe's infamous attack, that he lacked amenity, that his style was turgid and confused rather than natural, and that he darkened the beauty of his works by applying an excess of art. Birnbaum, in his function as Bach's mouthpiece articulating the composer's views on art and nature, elegantly counters Scheibe's broadside. The essential aims of true art are to imitate nature, and, where necessary, to aid it. If art imitates nature, then indisputably the natural element must everywhere shine through in works of art. Accordingly, it is impossible that art should take away the natural element from those things in which it imitates nature, including music. If art aids nature, then its aim is to preserve it and to improve its condition, certainly not to destroy it. Many things are delivered to us by nature in the most misshapen states, which, however, acquire the most beautiful appearance when they have been formed by art. Thus, art lends nature a beauty it lacks and increases the beauty it possesses. Now, the greater the art is, that is, the more industriously and painstakingly it works at the improvement of nature, the more brilliantly shines the beauty thus brought into being. Accordingly, it is impossible that the greatest art should darken the beauty of a thing. Birnbaum's argument draws in part on Gradus ad Parnassum, Steps to Parnassus, a 1725 counterpoint treatise whose author, Johann Joseph Fuchs, refers to art which imitates and perfects nature, but never destroys it. Bach owned a copy of this important Latin treatise, and may well have directed Birnbaum to emphasize the ancient Aristotelian principle, art imitates nature, a dictum that lay in the heart of what Bach considered musical science. For Bach, art lay between the reality of the world, nature, and God, who ordered this reality. Indeed, Leipzig philosophers subscribed to that relationship, especially when defining beauty and nature. What is art? An imitation of nature, writes Bach's student Lorenz Christoph Mietzler in the same year and place as Birnbaum's defense of Bach. It follows, then, that musical structure, harmonia, in the terminology of Bach's time, ultimately refers to the order of nature and to its divine cause. Or, put more lyrically, music is a mixed mathematical science that concerns the origins, attributes, and distinctions of sound, out of which a cultivated and lovely melody and harmony are made, so that God is honored and praised, but mankind is moved to devotion, virtue, joy, and sorrow. Strict rules and regulations, however they might be modified by rhetorical devices or by the new doctrine of affects, had largely kept musical composition in check, although Scheibe and other advocates of progressive concepts were charting a course toward a new aesthetic of art that would hold beauty and sensation as paramount. But the environment in which Bach worked and lived was not conducive to such ideas, nor did he seem to take much interest in them. On the other hand, he was surely influenced by the climate of inquiry and search for truth that now defined philosophy as a science of all things that teaches us how and why they are or can be. No less affected by the dream of intellectual unity than the leading thinkers of his generation, Bach pursued his own empirical line of inquiry by exploring the most hidden secrets of harmony with the most skilled artistry, by expanding, in scope, scale, and detail, the known limits of musical performance and composition. Bach's intricate musical art figured in a public literary dispute between Agricola and Filippo Finazzi, an opera singer in Hamburg, that recalls the Scheibe-Birnbaum controversy. In August 1750, just days after Bach's death, Agricola wrote, "He, Finazzi, denies his, Bach's, music the effect of pleasure for the listener who would not savor such difficult harmony. Yet, assuming the harmonies, that is, musical structures, of this great man were so complex that they would not always achieve the intended result, they nevertheless serve for the connoisseur's genuine delight. Not all learned people are able to understand a Newton, but those who have progressed far enough in profound science so that they can understand him will find the greater gratification and real benefit in reading his work." Here, for the first time, a parallel is drawn between Bach and Isaac Newton, not by constructing analogies between Bach's music and Newtonian science, but by explaining that Bach's music is best appreciated by real connoisseurs, just as Newton's writings are best understood by readers with a deep knowledge of science. Newton, a generation older than Bach, had earned a legendary reputation across Europe by the early 18th century, and by 1750 he represented the undisputed paradigm of the scientist as genius. The immortal Newton, as Mietzler called him, was especially revered in Leipzig, whose university had in Bach's time become the center of Newtonianism in Germany. Isaac Newton, it is still fair to say today, played the most critical role in the foundation of modern science. In addition to his most spectacular accomplishments, inventing calculus, discovering the laws of motion and the principles of optics, and explaining the concept of universal gravitation, his fundamental contributions covered an astounding range of fields. He studied space, time, heat, and the chemistry and theory of matter. He formulated the basic concepts of mass and dynamics. He invented the gravitational theory of tides, and he helped design such scientific instruments as the reflecting telescope. Toward the end of his career, he turned to alchemy, history, chronology, biblical exegesis, and theological issues. Newton's theoretical and experimental works exemplified a new kind of scientific method characterized by a kind of contrapuntal alternation between mathematical constructs and comparisons with the real world, in the words of a modern scholar. And a traditional element, typical of a pre-Enlightenment outlook, was Newton's firm belief that his discoveries pointed to the operations of God. Unlike later science, which focused solely on understanding nature, the Newtonian search for truth always encompassed both natural and divine principles. Trying to grasp the relationship between God and nature led Newton to explore the boundaries between them, where he ultimately saw the fusion of natural and divine principles. Newton's groundbreaking work, highly respected by his contemporaries, represents the pinnacle of the 17th century scientific revolution. Bach, on the other hand, created no revolution, but then the stakes were completely different. In the search for scientific truth, the principle of universal gravity, for example, would have been discovered eventually, if not by Newton, then by someone else. By contrast, the search for artistic truth cannot be guided by classical logic leading to a true or false result. The element of individuality plays too decisive a role in all artistic endeavors. Yet Bach's music, his search for truth, was affected more, both subconsciously and consciously, than that of any other contemporary musician by the spreading culture of Newtonianism and by the spirit of discovery that followed the scientific revolution, which no bright and keen intellect could escape. And under the umbrella of 17th century Lutheran theology, Bach's musical discoveries, like Newton's scientific advances, which Bach almost certainly did not know, took him to areas of the creative mind undreamed of before, and ultimately pointed to the operations of God. If the nature of philosophy of Bach's time defined itself as a science of all things that teaches us how and why they are or can be, Bach's musical philosophy might well be understood analogously, as the science of musical phenomena that teaches us how and why they are or can be, and also how they relate to nature, God's creation, and Newton's world system. The sheer scope and breadth of Newton's intellectual endeavors, too, find their analogy in the enormous and unparalleled range of interests and enterprises that characterize Bach, the complete, the learned, the perfect musician. For Bach, schooled in 17th century thought, the concept that music formed a branch of the liberal arts quadrivium is still as valid as it had been for Johannes Kepler, who promoted the view that music mirrored the harmony of the universe. Music, then, with its traditional mathematical underpinning, provided an especially rich field of operation for a composer who was increasingly infected with scientific curiosity, totally uninterested in dry exercises in musical craftsmanship, but thoroughly committed to advancing true music, which Bach defined as music that pursued as its ultimate end or final goal the honor of God and the recreation of the soul. A list of Bach's major achievements in musical science testifies to his emphatic and consistent application of the principle of counterpoint, that is, the dynamic discourse of melodically and rhythmically distinct voices resulting in his unique compositional style. Such a list would include the following areas of compositional art, which reflect a process of musical research that uncovers the most hidden secrets of polyphony, the application of ingenious and unusual ideas, and the employment of the most skilled artistry. The works cited are merely representative. Fugue and Canon, the art of fugue. Major-minor tonality, the well-tempered clavier. Harmonic expansion, the chromatic fantasy and fugue. Extended polyphony, the unaccompanied violin, cello, and flute pieces. Instrumentation, the Brandenburg concertos. Instrumental and vocal genres. Bach employed virtually all contemporary models and types, from aria, cantata burlesque, and canzona to oratorio, scherzo, and sinfonia. Small-scale form, the Orgelbuchlein, and large-scale form, the St. Matthew Passion. Style and compositional technique from retrospective to modern, the B minor mass. Musical affect and meaning, the church cantatas. Further essential features of Bach's musicianship comprise his keyboard virtuosity and his development of new manual and pedal techniques, taking into account the ergonomics of posture that carried over to other instrumental and vocal performance. His intense involvement in musical instrument technology, especially in organ building and design, which required considerable experience in mathematics, physics, acoustics, architecture, and mechanical engineering, organ and clavier serving as indispensable pieces of equipment in Bach's experimental musical laboratory, and his distinctive contributions to understanding the relationships between music, language, rhetoric, poetics, and theology. Finally, of especial importance was Bach's remarkable ability to synthesize the various components of his musical science in light of his strong sense for unified structures. Although Bach realized the significance of theoretical discourse and must have encouraged his students to contribute to it, he himself did not. He focused instead on practical elaborations for the instruction and delight of those who have a concept of what is possible in art and who desire original thought and its special, unusual elaboration, as Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach wrote after his father's death. Bach was one of the most active, dedicated, and prolific teachers the world has seen. As a result, many students of his worked to disseminate his music and teachings through their own writings. In fact, soon after 1750, German music theory reoriented itself almost solely because of the prevailing influence of the Bach school, and European music theory followed half a century later. If Bach ever came close to creating a revolution, it was his teaching of composition by fully integrating the principles of thorough bass, harmony, and counterpoint, elements that had previously been treated separately. This method was illustrated by two works that were circulated widely from the moment of Bach's death, first in manuscript and later in printed form, the Well-Tempered Clavier, which defined the principles of free and strict composition, and the collection of 370-plus four-part chorales that charted the course for tonal harmony. The Scheibe-Birnbaum controversy had turned out to be a tempest in a teapot. The impact of Bach's music and teachings was such that when the focus of the music world had clearly shifted to the Vienna of Haydn and Mozart, the musician and critic Christian Friedrich Daniel Schubart could already refer to Bach as a genius of the highest order and, as Agricola had done years earlier, rank him on a par with the greatest scientist genius. What Newton was as a philosopher, Bach was as a musician. In other words, as Newton brought about fundamental changes and established new principles in the world of science, Bach did the same in the world of music, both in composition and in performance. At the turn of the 19th century, Schubart's appraisal was not only echoed but reinforced in the leading music periodical of the day to which Beethoven and others subscribed. The name of Johann Sebastian Bach radiates supremely and sublimely above those of all German composers in the first half of the past century. He embraced with Newton's spirit everything that has hitherto been thought about harmony, composition, and that has been presented as examples thereof, and he penetrated its depths so completely and felicitously that he must be justly regarded as the lawmaker of genuine harmony, which is valid up to the present day. By 1800, the continuing, indeed permanent, relevance of the new foundations that Bach, the lawmaker of genuine composition, had laid was clearly recognized. These provided the basis for the romantic concept of pure music, defined as a beautiful play with tones governed by an aesthetic idea. In 1799, the same periodical had published a diagram in the form of a sun of composers. There, at the center, appears the name of Johann Sebastian Bach, surrounded in various layers by the names of other composers, the first layer comprising Georg Friedrich Handel, Carl Heinrich Graun, and Franz Joseph Haydn. And Haydn, whose reputation by that time as Europe's premier composer was beyond question, is said to have been not unfavorably impressed by it, nor minded the proximity to Handel and Graun, nor considered it at all wrong that Johann Sebastian Bach was the center of the sun, and hence the man from whom all true musical wisdom proceeded. Who is this man from whom all true musical wisdom proceeded? In the absence of a true classical model such as we have in literature, art, and architecture going back to antiquity, Bach's musical science, its beauty and expression included, offers a stable frame of reference even today that neither a Palestrina nor a Monteverdi, a Handel, a Beethoven, nor any other composer can provide. His is the kind of musical wisdom that is experienced alike by the keyboard beginner playing the two-part Inventiones and the virtuoso tackling the unaccompanied cello suites, by the beginning harmony student and the mature composer, by the inexperienced listener and the sophisticated concertgoer. Throughout his life, Bach constantly strove to perfect himself in his quest for true musical wisdom. According to his obituary, he, along with all members of the Bach family, was deemed to have received a love and aptitude for music as a gift of nature. But he himself reportedly said that, "What I have achieved by industry and practice, anyone else with tolerable natural gift and ability can also achieve." This statement would place him once again in the vicinity of a Newton. In A Dissertation Upon Genius of 1755, William Sharp attempts to show that the several instances of distinction and degrees of superiority in human genius are not fundamentally the result of nature, but the effect of acquisition. When and how Johann Sebastian Bach acquired what cannot be easily determined. At any rate, because Bach's timeless and global impact is not revealed in the narrow confines of his life story, all the more does understanding the musical science that underlies his works allow us some insight into his intellectual biography. 1. Springs of Musical Talent and Lifelong Influences. Eisenach, 1685 through 1695. Ambrosius Bach and his family. By an auspicious coincidence, Sebastian Nagel, town piper of Gotha and friend of Johann Ambrosius Bach, happened to be in Eisenach on the third weekend in March 1685. Whatever brought him to the town at this time, he most likely joined his fellow town piper Bach for a performance, probably one in need of reinforcement by outside musicians. They were used to helping each other out. It made sense for the musicians from the two towns 18 miles apart and seats of neighboring ducal courts to team up for special occasions. Nagel and Bach, each in his capacities as town piper, director of town music, and member of the ducal capella, the court's performing ensemble, were in charge of such events. Thus it was that on the day following Oakley Sunday, 4 weeks before Easter, Sebastian Nagel and his colleague Ambrosius Bach, together with the ducal forester Johann Georg Koch, arrayed themselves around the ancient baptismal font inside St. George's, Eisenach's main church. Magister Johann Christoph Zerbst functioned as the officiating minister at the baptism of the child born to Ambrosius and Maria Elisabeth Bach on the previous Saturday, March 21st. Nagel was given the honor of holding the baby over the baptismal font because he was the one of the two godfathers from whom the boy was to receive his middle name, Sebastian. The short ceremony took place on a historic site at the foot of the Wartburg, the medieval hilltop castle overlooking Eisenach. The Wartburg had formed the setting in 1207 for the famous Tourney of Song, a historic high point of German minstrelsy, and 3 centuries later provided refuge to Martin Luther while he translated the Greek New Testament into German. The venerable St. George's Church, an ancient structure whose origins date back to 1182, had witnessed the wedding in 1221 of Landgrave Louis IV of Thuringia and Elizabeth, daughter of Hungarian King Andrew II. Later canonized as St. Elizabeth, she led a simple life and personally tended the sick and the poor. The church had been substantially rebuilt in 1515, and Luther had preached there in the spring of 1521 on his way both to and from the Diet in Worms. No stranger to Eisenach, the city of his mother's birth, Luther spent the years 1498 to 1501 at the Eisenach Latin School, the same school that the child being baptized was later to attend. Perhaps the older among the little boy's siblings observed the short christening ceremony. His mother, however, was excluded, for according to the strict customs prescribed by the Hebrew Bible and upheld by Lutherans of the time, she was not permitted to enter church until she had undergone a religious purification rite 6 weeks after childbirth. She may have participated in choosing the child's godfathers and thereby also in selecting his name, but both parents must have known that no other member of the extended Thuringian family of musicians bore the name Sebastian. Had they been interested in a name more readily found among family members, Johann Georg Koch, the ducal forester, could have served in Nagel's place. After all, Georg was the name of Ambrosius's elder brother, cantor in Schweinfurt on the Main. Nevertheless, Ambrosius, perhaps proud of the singularity within the family of his own name, not only favored the unique Sebastian, he also chose a fellow musician as name-lending godfather. It may not be mere coincidence that a generation later, Johann Sebastian and Maria Barbara Bach selected similarly uncommon names for their two elder sons, Wilhelm Friedemann and Carl Philipp Emanuel. The name Johann Sebastian, however, would recur in the family only twice. In 1713, Ambrosius Bach's eldest son, Johann Christoph, named one of his children after his then already famous brother in Weimar, who acted as godfather at the baptism. But the baby died before he was 2 months old. Then in 1748, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach named his firstborn after his father, who at the time felt unfit to travel from Leipzig to Berlin for the baptism. Johann Sebastian Bach Jr., not a musician but a gifted draftsman and painter of landscapes whose artistry was greatly admired by his contemporaries, died in 1778 in Rome at the age of 29. Thus, without any action on his part, the Eisenach Johann Sebastian acquired an unmistakable and unambiguous name identification. If anything can be said for certain about what the parents of the first Johann Sebastian in the Bach family expected of their son, it is that he would become a musician. In the Thuringian towns of the region stretching from Erfurt to Eisenach, the family name Bach had become nearly synonymous with musician. Indeed, when a vacancy occurred in 1693 at the Arnstadt Court Capella, the court urgently called for a Bach. Although Johann Sebastian's extraordinarily individual musical personality and his future singular stature could have been neither expected nor predicted, the fear expressed later by his stepmother that the springs of musical talent in the family might run dry was unwarranted. It was simply assumed that the background, working conditions, and living circumstances of a family of professional musicians would exert an inescapable and deep influence on all of its newborn members. Before coming to Eisenach in 1671 as director of town music, Johann Ambrosius Bach had become town piper in Arnstadt and then, from April 1667, a violinist in the town music company, an ensemble of professional musicians employed by the town council of his native Erfurt. With its 18,000 inhabitants, Erfurt was by far Thuringia's largest city and the region's historical, cultural, educational, and commercial center. Politically part of the electoral archbishopric of Mainz, Erfurt also represented a bi-confessional entity, about 20% Roman Catholic, within the traditional Lutheran heartland. In the 16th century, the ancient region of Thuringia, ruled by the Ernestine branch of the Saxon House of Wettin, split into several duchies, Saxe-Altenburg, Saxe-Eisenach, Saxe-Gotha, etc., while the Albertine electoral section of Saxony with its capital Dresden remained intact as a political geographical unit. Situated within the Ernestine duchies, in addition to the enclave of Erfurt and the free imperial city of Mühlhausen, two metropolitan areas, were several independent principalities ruled primarily by the counts of Schwarzburg, Arnstadt, Rudolstadt, and Sonderhausen, Hagleiken, Ohrdruf, and Reuss, Gera, Greiz. One of the most densely populated areas in Europe, dotted with countless small towns in a politically fractured landscape, Thuringia developed into an economically and culturally vigorous region soon after the catastrophic 30 Years' War ended in 1648. Some of the most important intersections of east-west and north-south continental trade routes made the area particularly susceptible to foreign influences, in art and architecture, most notably from Italian and French traditions. Here, as almost nowhere else to such an extent, the manifold European trends met and merged, generating a unique climate that also paved the way for the early 18th century concept of a mixed style in music. Ambrosius was born in Erfurt on February 22, 1645, son of Christoph Bach and Maria Magdalena, née Grabler. Christoph Bach served from 1642 to 1654 as town musician in Erfurt, and therefore as town and court musician in Arnstadt, 11 miles away. Ambrosius and his twin brother Christoph received their musical training in Arnstadt, first with their father, and after his death in 1661, with their father's younger brother, Heinrich. After spending the customary 5 years as apprentice and 2 years as journeyman in Arnstadt, Ambrosius was appointed to a post in the Erfurt Town Music Company vacated by his cousin Johann Christian, who in 1667 was promoted to the band's directorship. In Erfurt, Ambrosius was also given the opportunity to work with another member of the town music company, his father's older brother Johann, organist at the Prediger Church and the first distinguished musician and composer in the family. This made Ambrosius the only one among 9 grandsons of Hans Bach to learn from and work with all 3 sons of the family's first professional musician. On April 8, 1668, a year after joining the Erfurt Town Music Company, Ambrosius Bach married Maria Elisabeth Lammerhirt, the 24-year-old daughter of the late Valentin Lammerhirt, an affluent furrier and a longtime and influential town council member in Erfurt. Elisabeth's much older stepsister, Hedwig, had already provided a family link. In 1638, she had married Johann Bach and born 3 musical sons, Christian, Aegidius, and Nikolaus. A generation later, Johann Sebastian Bach's older sister Maria Salome would marry the Erfurt master furrier and business partner of the Lammerhirts, Johann Andreas Wiegand. thereby affirming relations between the Bach family and the Erfurt bourgeoisie, connections that secured a Bach dominance in the Erfurt musical scene for nearly a century. The stage set by the Johann Bach-Valentin-Lammerhirt connection with the town council led to a complete reorganization of the Erfurt Town Music Company in the 1660s. Johann Bach not only employed all three of his own sons, he also arranged for the appointments of his brothers' twins, Christoph and Ambrosius. Christoph came first in 1666, and Ambrosius followed a few months later, receiving his appointment on April 12, 1667, just one day after his cousin Johann Christian became director of the town music company. Connections played a role in Ambrosius Bach's next appointment as well. The town piper of Eisenach, Christoph Schmidt, died in 1670, creating a vacancy there. His daughter Margareta was married to Johann Christian Bach of Erfurt, Ambrosius's cousin, who had apprenticed with Schmidt in Eisenach. Moreover, Christian Bach's brother, Johann Aegidius, was married to another Schmidt daughter. On top of that, another of Ambrosius's cousins, Johann Christoph, had served since 1665 as town organist and later also as a member of the court capella in Eisenach. In short, the connections could hardly have been better, and after a pro forma audition in Eisenach on October 12, 1671, Ambrosius Bach was hired on the spot. An honorarium and expenses, as well as 2 days' meals and beer, were provided for the new town piper and the musicians he had with him. Ambrosius had auditioned with four consorts, and it seems that he brought along to his new job four assistants. Three apprentices and one journeyman was a typical complement. His appointment to the directorship of the Eisenach Town Music Company attests to the talents of the 26-year-old musician, as does his initial salary. Whereas his predecessor Schmidt had for decades been paid a salary of 27 florins, 7 groschen, 8 pfennigs, and a housing supplement of 8 florins, Ambrosius's starting salary jumped to 40 florins, 4 groschen, 8 pfennigs, and a housing supplement of 10 florins. For a table of money and living costs in Bach's time, see Appendix 3 of the bonus material to this audiobook. He also earned a considerable supplementary income, more than twice his salary, from various sources, including the court capella. From the very beginning, Ambrosius Bach's musical services to the town and the court were highly appreciated, as they continued to be throughout his tenure. In fact, no Eisenach musician in the entire 17th century received as much praise as Ambrosius did. References to his extraordinary kind of music making appear early on. One document, which exempts him from the local brewery tax, not only points to his Christian virtues and moral conduct, but praises his particular professional qualifications in that he can come up with vocal and instrumental music for worship service and for honorable assemblies with persons of higher and lower ranks in such a way that we cannot remember having ever experienced anything like it in this place. Similarly, a town chronicler's report displays unparalleled enthusiasm. In 1672 at Easter, the new town piper made music with organ, violins, voices, trumpets, and military drums, as had never before been done by any cantor or town musician as long as Eisenach stood. The event referred to here, a festive Easter service at St. George's, actually marked the auspicious beginning of a new era in Eisenach's history. That spring, Duke Johann Georg I of Saxe-Eisenach moved his residence permanently from Marksuhl in the countryside to Eisenach, reestablished the old town as the capital of an independent principality. In October 1671, Ambrosius and Elisabeth Bach moved from Erfurt, where they had an apartment in Johann Bach's house, the Silver Pocket at Jukersand Eine, to Eisenach with their four-month-old son Johann Christoph. He was their second child. Johann Rudolf, the firstborn, had died before he was half a year old. Six children were born later in Eisenach: Johann Balthasar, Johannes Jonas, Maria Saloma, Johanna Judita, Johann Jakob, and Johann Sebastian. Since Johannes Jonas died at the age of 10 in 1685, just about 2 months after Johann Sebastian's birth, and Johanna Judita 1 year later at age 6, Sebastian grew up with four siblings. but he rarely saw the oldest of them, Christoph, who left Eisenach in 1686 when he was 15 in order to study with Johann Pachelbel in Erfurt. Moreover, Balthasar, who in 1688 became an apprentice to his father, died at the age of 18. When the 16-year-old Sebastian attended his brother's burial in 1691, it was his first conscious encounter with a death within his close circle, a situation he would eventually be exposed to much sooner, more often, and more seriously than many. In fact, from age 6, Sebastian lived with his parents, one sister, Salome, and one brother, Jakob, in a family of sadly diminished and still diminishing size. He would survive all of his siblings by a considerable margin. His oldest brother died in 1721 as organist and schoolteacher in Ordruf, his brother Jakob a year later as court musician in Stockholm, and his sister Salome Wiegand in 1728 in Erfurt. In the absence of public social and welfare programs, family and self-reliance played a major role in managing all kinds of hardships, and through several generations, the extended Bach family was exemplary in this respect. When Ambrosius moved from Erfurt to Eisenach, he took along his youngest sister, Dorothea Maria, then 19, and in need of intensive care because she was seriously handicapped, both physically and mentally. The family was also joined by Eva Barbara Lammerhirt, Elisabeth Bach's widowed mother, who left her Erfurt home perhaps in order to provide a helping hand to her daughter and her growing family, but perhaps also because she needed help herself. She died just 1 year after the move in 1673, and Dorothea Maria did not live much longer either. She was buried in 1679. 3 years later, two of Ambrosius's cousins, Christian and Nikolaus, fell victim to the plague that swept through Erfurt in 1682-83 and diminished the city's population by almost half. Their colleague and friend Johann Pachelbel lost his wife and baby soon as well. To escape the plague, Christian's son Johann Jakob, born 1668, moved to Eisenach and became an apprentice and then journeyman to Ambrosius. He remained with his uncle for almost 10 years, but died of an unknown cause in 1692. For young Sebastian, the second death at home within a year. From July 1683, Ambrosius and Elisabeth Bach took care of the orphaned 1-year-old Johann Nikolaus, who was born shortly after his father Nikolaus had died of the plague in July 1682. When the boy's mother died almost exactly a year later, it fell to Elisabeth to provide a home for her stepsister's grandson. Johann Nikolaus later went to school together with his younger cousin Sebastian and left Eisenach for Erfurt only after Elisabeth Bach's death in 1694. The Eisenach Bach's house was always full, populated not only with children and relatives, but also with the apprentices. This meant that the house ordinarily had to accommodate 3 additional people between 15 and 20 years of age, assuming that the 4th of the town piper's consorts was a journeyman who provided his own accommodation. Clearly, the need for adequate living quarters for the director of the town band cannot be underestimated. At first, Ambrosius rented an apartment in the house of the ducal head forester, Balthasar Schneider, near the Frauenplan, site of today's Ritterstrasse 11. After Ambrosius and his family acquired citizenship in Eisenach in 1674, they purchased a home. This house, however, in which Sebastian was born, no longer stands. Situated at the Fleischgasse, the site of today's Lutherstrasse 35 in the center of town, the house was registered in Ambrosius Bach's name from 1675 to 1695. Among his later neighbors on the same street were his cousin Johann Christoph Bach and the cantor Andreas Christian Dedekind. When Ambrosius purchased the house, he probably used funds left by his mother-in-law, Eva Barbara Lammerhirt. Since the Lammerhirts ran a successful fur business in Erfurt, from which Johann Sebastian later received a generous inheritance, town councillor Valentine Lammerhirt's widow had not been left without means. Before joining her daughter's household in Eisenach, she had sold her Erfurt house to Johann Bach for 120 florins. In general, there was no serious financial trouble in Ambrosius Bach's household, quite the opposite of the rather desperate economic situation in which, for example, his Eisenach cousin and companion, the town organist Johann Christoph, constantly found himself. In early 1684, Ambrosius was offered the directorship of the town music company in Erfurt, a post that had been vacant since the death of Johann Christian Bach in 1682 and that had remained unfulfilled while the plague was still raging. His native Erfurt, three times the size of Eisenach, made Ambrosius an attractive offer that compared favorably with his present situation. He wrote to the Eisenach town council describing the financial burden of providing for a family with six children and of employing three journeymen and an unspecified number of apprentices, the abatement of additional income resulting from frequent public mourning periods, and the constant quarrels with the beer fiddlers, freelance musicians, who were interfering with his business. In short, he explained that conditions in Erfurt would permit a more cost-efficient and pleasant life. Though neither the Eisenach town council nor the ducal court consented to his request for dismissal, they did agree to pay him an indemnity of one florin during public mourning periods. Johann Sebastian would have been born in Erfurt had his parents left Eisenach then, but as it was, he grew up in the town below the Wartburg in an environment that significantly shaped his talents, character, and outlook. In the ambiance of home, town, court, school, and church. Johann Sebastian Bach's baptism in 1685 took place in the immediate vicinity, within a diameter of no more than an eighth of a mile, of the four institutions that formed the foundation of 17th century musical culture in Germany: town, court, school, and church. All four would not only play an essential role in Bach's later career, they also influenced the boy's formative years from the very beginning. The town hall with its music ensemble, the civic organization chiefly responsible for official and public musical events, the ducal castle with its court capella, the center of aristocratic musical patronage, St. George's Latin School with its chorus musicus, the primary domicile of high-level musical education, and St. George's Church with its organ and choir loft, the principal home of sacred music. Church, castle, and town hall faced the market square in the city's busy center, and the little boy Sebastian must often have gone from one establishment to another, first at his father's side, watching him perform his duties, later fulfilling minor chores, perhaps as assistant stage manager, page turner, or the like, and eventually as a student at the Latin school and as a choir boy. It all began at home, of course, and was brought back there as well. The house of a town piper, though not an institution as such, nevertheless served as a central establishment of professional music making. Sebastian could not have realized that everything he experienced amounted to a concrete preview of his later activities, but he must have understood and probably never questioned that this was indeed his world and always would be. Throughout his life, he remained truthful to his Eisenach background and loyal to his Eisenach citizenship, the only one he ever carried. Later, and surely with pride, he often added his place of origin to his name: Johann Sebastian Bach Eisenachus, or Eisenachensis, or in the abbreviated form, ISBI. Eisenach, a town of some 6,000 when Bach was born, lay well positioned on the so-called Hohe, or Oberstrasse, at the time a major east-west trade and post route in Germany, between Leipzig and Frankfurt on the Main, or, viewed on a larger scale, between Warsaw and Eastern Europe on the one hand, and the Rhineland, northern France, and the Netherlands on the other. Like almost everywhere else in central Germany, Eisenach had been hard hit by the 30 Years' War, and by the time Ambrosius Bach arrived, the town had barely recovered from its turmoils. Hence the year 1672, when the city became the capital of an independent principality, marked an important turning point that basically coincided with the beginning of Ambrosius's tenure of office. The new political status of the town, whose population by 1710 would grow to around 9,000, had a direct impact on its economy and culture, and, by implication, on the musical scene at large, with the latter serving primarily but not exclusively the purposes of the court. For example, the mere fact that the dukes moved their official residence to the city made their principal church of the town the court church, a situation that affected in particular the feast days of the liturgical year. For the Lutheran church calendar, see Appendix 4 of the bonus material to this audiobook. The town piper's house on the Fleischgasse also served as a base for Ambrosius's professional activities. As a result, Sebastian absorbed from the very beginning an atmosphere dominated by music and musicians, involving the entire family and almost all who lived with them. Ambrosius typically employed four assistants, of which two or three were apprentices. They were entitled to room and board in the town piper's house in exchange for services. An apprentice learned to play all types of musical instruments and generally stayed with his master for 5 to 6 years, by which time he reached the status of journeyman. After traveling and working with different masters or staying on with the original master and gaining more experience, a journeyman could then apply to fill vacant spots in the town music company. These salaried positions were usually available in two categories, art fiddlers and the high-ranked town pipers. In Thuringia, the head town piper was usually called Hausmann, a traditional term deriving from his original function as the tower guard, who was also responsible for winding the public clocks. When Sebastian was 3 years old, his second oldest brother, 15-year-old Balthasar, having reached a certain level of musical proficiency, began to apprentice with his father. Sebastian could thus observe both his father and his big brother at work. The numerous musical activities of family members and apprentices that penetrated domestic life at the town piper's house consisted not merely of teaching, practicing, rehearsing, and performing, but also of collecting and copying music, repairing and maintaining musical instruments, and other endeavors related to an extended music business establishment. There is no question that in an age when child labor was a mere matter of course, the sons of Ambrosius Bach became involved in their father's activities from early on, whether carrying music or instruments, cleaning brass, or restringing fiddles. They would also have assisted in performances by playing various instruments according to the level of proficiency they had acquired, versatility counting among the most fundamental and useful musical virtues. Ambrosius's duties as director of the Eisenach Town Music Company included, according to his contract, two primary obligations. The first was performing twice daily at 10 a.m. and 5 p.m. with a band of five at the town hall. This oblassen, literally blowing off, of so-called tower pieces, mostly for sham or sackbut ensembles, usually sonatas, intradas, dances, and chorales, normally took place on the balcony of the town hall and rang out over the entire marketplace. The second duty was performing at worship services in St. George's Church on all Sundays and feast days, before and after the sermon and also at the afternoon vespers, as directed by the cantor. All additional activities were undertaken for separate fees, resulting in supplementary income that typically exceeded Ambrosius's annual salary by a considerable margin. They included playing at such civic events as town council elections and receptions for out-of-town dignitaries, and at weddings, funerals, and other private occasions. Eisenach citizens needing musical services were required to hire the members of the town music company. Beer fiddlers could serve only if the town's musicians were unavailable or needed reinforcement. In such cases, the guild regulations specified that the town musicians were to collect the regular fee while the beer fiddlers would receive just a gratuity. These regulations naturally led to constant quarreling over the exclusive, jealously guarded rights of the town musicians. They were often violated as well by townsfolk seeking specially discounted services at weddings, and Ambrosius complained more than once about pointed disagreements and unpleasant relationships with the beer fiddlers. Shortly after taking up his post in October 1671 as Hausmann in Eisenach, Ambrosius became an affiliated member of the Ducal Court Capella, an ensemble of modest size established under Dukes Johann Georg I, reigning 1672 through 1686, and Johann Georg II, reigning 1686 through 1698, of Saxe-Eisenach. When in 1672 Johann Georg I moved to Eisenach, the violinist Daniel Eberlin and four trumpeters came along from Marxuhl, the previous ducal residence, and formed the nucleus of a new court capella. They were joined by the violinist and dance master Jean Perisson and the lutenist Louis Perizel. Eberlin, who dedicated to the Duke his principal published instrumental opus, a set of trio sonatas, received an official appointment as court kapellmeister, leader of the court musicians, and master of the pages in 1685, a position he occupied for 7 years. His future son-in-law, Georg Philipp Telemann, served as court kapellmeister from 1708 to 1712. In addition to the few full-time members, the Capella drew on part-time musicians who functioned as lackeys and filled court service positions of various kinds. They were also regularly joined by the town musician Ambrosius Bach and his cousin, the town organist Christoph Bach, who both held court appointments. According to his contract, Ambrosius was required always to perform with his people, the town music company, in the court Capella. For special events, the court recruited additional musical personnel from neighboring town and court ensembles at Kassel, Gotha, and Arnstadt. In 1690, a band of woodwind players was added as a fashionable musical innovation, providing the Capella with a regular complement of oboes, recorders, bassoons, and drums. Also, for a period of 1 year, beginning in May 1677, the 24-year-old Johann Pachelbel served the Eisenach Capella before he went on to Erfurt as organist of the Predigerkirche, where he succeeded Johann Bach. Pachelbel's short stay clearly left a mark on Ambrosius Bach's family, suggesting a close, cordial, and lasting friendship. In 1680, Pachelbel became godfather to Ambrosius's daughter Johanna Juditha, though he was unable to travel from Erfurt for the baptism, and in 1686, teacher and mentor of Ambrosius's son Johann Christoph, at whose Ohrdruf wedding in 1694, Pachelbel performed along with his friends among the extended Bach family. In addition to the town hall and castle, the third building, located at Eisenach's large main square that made up Ambrosius Bach's base of operations, was the imposing 12th-century St. George's Church, which served both the townspeople and the ducal court. The nave of the church, with its three galleries on the south and north sides, was designed to hold more than 2,000 worshipers. Here, in the western choir and organ gallery, Ambrosius regularly played with his consorts on all Sundays and feast days, and for special services such as funerals and weddings. As well as accompanying the choir, they performed with vocal soloists in all sorts of concerted pieces. The choir consisted of students from the Latin school's chorus musicus, or chorus symphoniacus, or cantore, who were selected on the basis of their musical experience and were granted stipends as choral scholars. The cantor, choral director, also served as teacher of the fourth class, quarta. At the beginning of Ambrosius's Eisenach tenure, Johann Andreas Schmidt served as cantor. He was succeeded in 1690 by Andreas Christian Dedekind, who had previously served as cantor in Arnstadt, where he became a good friend of the Bach family. The school's chorus musicus supplied the church with polyphonic music for regular services throughout the ecclesiastical year and for special services. It also performed for secular occasions such as town council elections, civic ceremonies, for example at the town hall's Ratskeller for the New Year's Day celebration, staged comedies, and certain courtly events such as birthdays in the ducal family. By tradition, several times a year and especially around New Year's Day, the chorus musicus divided into smaller groups, so-called Kurinden, that sang in the streets of Eisenach and outlying villages to collect money for the teachers and needy students. Martin Luther had once been among such kurenda singers. According to the Weimar Church Order of 1664, which also applied to Eisenach, there were four designated places for polyphony in the liturgy of the main Sunday worship service: after the readings of the Epistle and the Gospel, after the sermon, and during communion. The standard repertoire included motets and other unaccompanied a cappella music, as available in the so-called Eisenach Kantzional. This book, compiled around 1535 and used throughout the 17th century, contained compositions by Johann Walter, Ludwig Senfel, Josquin des Prez, Jakob Obrecht, Thomas Stolzer, and others. More recent music was also performed: works by Michael Praetorius, Johann Hermann Schein, Heinrich Schütz, and Andreas Hammerschmidt; motet collections for 4 to 8 voices by Abraham Schadeus, Melchior Frank, Samuel Scheidt, and Ambrosius Profe; and compositions of Eisenach's own Johann Christoph Bach. Vocal concertos or concertato motets invariably required the participation of the town musicians and, on rarer occasions, also the kapellistin of the court, who were joined with the chorus musicus. The combined forces were usually led by the cantor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.